Hello, testing, testing. Are we all set to get ready here? All right, good evening, everybody. Thank you for coming tonight to our public information session. Just so everyone knows, this is a public information session that we're having on the stretch energy code. We have an ordinance that has been put before the city council, and we're trying to figure out whether or not the stretch energy code is something that is good for the city. And we recognize that it's a very complicated issue, a lot of moving pieces to it. And so what the council has decided was to have a public information session to open it up to the public a little bit more broadly than what we typically do in our council meetings. And so the goal here is to have the experts come in and talk about this program. By way of background, my name is Christian Scorzoni. I am one of the city councilors here in Amesbury, representing District 2. It's my first term on the council, and I'm also the chair of the Energy Task Force here in the city. I just want to recognize that we have several of the members of the Amesbury City Council here. I see Council President Ferguson is here, Councilor Neal is here, I don't know who else, Councilor McClure is here as well too, and I'm sure we're going to be having others. We've got about a handful of folks from the Energy Task Force here, representatives from the Chamber of Commerce are here, we appreciate that. And then we have folks from the administration as well. I see Dennis Nadeau, Joe Fahey, and Eric Weglor from the mayor's office as well. So thank you all for coming. Just by way of background, I'll just say that I filed this ordinance because what my prior experience has been that I've about 2 years ago, I was working in state government and working in the Energy and Environmental Affairs Office, and state had an aggressive game plan to adopt stringent renewable and energy efficiency activities, and so they've created this new program, the Green Communities Program, where they've asked for cities and towns to pass a series of ordinances that would allow them to become more green and then ultimately access a pot of monies from the state so that they can do energy efficiency projects and renewable activities for the city, and then enter into competitive grant funding every year. And so I thought it would be a good thing to pursue. Clearly the state's pushing hard on these areas. We're gonna hear from a couple of speakers tonight. First is gonna be Joanne Bassetta. Joanne is our Northeast Regional Green Communities Director at the Department of Energy Resources. She's the one that is our liaison in this part of the state on the Green Communities Program. She's gonna speak about the overall program, what it means for communities to adopt it, what are the requirements, what are the benefits. Again, as we mentioned earlier, one of the five requirements is the adoption of the Stretch Energy Code. And we have Mike Berry here. He is from ICF. Very familiar with the code, can speak to the ins and outs of the code, and hopefully talk a little bit about utility incentives that are involved with trying to be compliant with the code. Hopefully, after hearing from these folks, we can have a good discussion about any of the program for you. I also want to recognize Molly Ettenbrose here from City of Newburyport. We're very curious to know what Newburyport's experience has been as they went through this process. Newburyport adopted the Stretch Energy Code and ultimately the Green Community Program back in 2009. And so I think we have some lessons to be learned from their experience as well that we're hoping to get tonight. So with that, I'll hand it over to Joanne Bassetta. She has a PowerPoint that she's gonna go through, and then after that we'll have some questions, if that's okay. Thank you.
Adjust the mic. Can you all hear me okay? Ah, come back. Slideshow. From the beginning. Okay. Good evening. I'm happy to be back in Amesbury. I was here back, I think it was May, and with an introductory presentation about the Green Communities Program. It's really pretty at night with all the lights sprinkling. Christian said, I am the Northeast Regional Coordinator. I work with 84 cities and towns north of, in the Boston area as well as north. And in addition to the Green Communities Grant Program, which I'm going to talk about a little bit, we do a number of other things. I'm essentially the field person and with anything energy related. So we have other programs that we offer to cities and towns, helping with resources to develop renewable energy, helping with accessing utility rebates for efficiency programs, those types of things. If I don't have the answer, I go to the, I find the answer for communities. So the Green Communities Program was established as part of the Green Communities Act, which was passed in 2008. And this law has a number of different components to it. One of them is to establish direct assistance to cities and towns to help them with energy needs. And it sets aside some money, $10 million a year to go to cities and towns to help with energy projects. But to get to have access to these funds, the towns must do five things, meet the five criteria. I'm just going to talk about the five of them briefly. The reason we're having this meeting is to spend a lot of time on the fifth one, but I just wanted to give you some context as to why we're here and some of the other activities that the city would need to do to become a green community. The first one has to do with as-of-right siting for renewable or alternative energy facilities. These could be facilities that generate energy, such as a wind turbine or a large-scale solar project, or it could be a research and development facility, a fuel cell researcher, things like that, or it could be a manufacturing facility. It doesn't have to be all three. So whatever of those types of land uses best fits your community, the community tends to follow that path. Quite often, communities already have this in place with their current zoning, so that's something should Amesbury decide to pursue green communities, I will work with them to go over the zoning materials and see what the situation is. The second criteria is related to the first criteria, and it has to do with permitting these facilities. And what we would like is communities to have what we call an expedited permitting process. And for us, expedited is one calendar year. So if a fuel cell manufacturer wants to develop a facility in Amesbury, it's allowed by right. They submit a building permit and any other applications to the city. The city has 1 year to grant the permit. And most communities already have this in place, and it's not a big deal at all. The third requirement is now looking at the city's energy use, the municipal energy use. So it would be city buildings, school buildings, vehicles, traffic lights, anything that the city uses. It's essentially looking at the energy footprint, if you will, of the city. And establishing a baseline, so it's to analyze, how much energy in a given time does the city use, and then come up with a plan to reduce that energy use by 20% in 5 years. And this is, I call this the term paper. It often takes a good deal of effort. We have tools to help communities do this. We have online energy software that is free to cities and towns to use, and we work with cities and towns to help them do this, but it does take a little bit of effort. The fourth one has to do with vehicles. We would like communities to purchase fuel-efficient vehicles, and we have a model policy. And it's fairly, modest. We're not expecting fleets to all of a sudden become all Priuses or Prii. It sets a standard of miles per gallon based on vehicle class. So something like a Ford F-150, for instance, is considered fuel-efficient for a standard pickup truck. So it's not something terribly onerous. These are vehicles that most cities tend to purchase anyway. There are some vehicles that there's no fuel-efficient models available, so we don't expect you to buy them. Fire trucks, ambulances, big dump trucks, police cruisers. There aren't any fuel-efficient police cruisers out right now. So again, we have model guidelines and templates, and again, we assist communities going through this process. The fifth one has to do with building, new construction. As we sit in this chili, I'm all for chili. I like chili. I'd rather be chili than hot. But as we sit in you know, older buildings, a lot of New England communities have older buildings, and it takes a lot of effort to retrofit them to become more energy efficient. So the fifth requirement is building the building correctly in the first place, looking at, you know, using the tools that are available to build energy efficient buildings. So the fifth one is dealing with new construction, and the way to go about it is to adopt the stretch code, which my friend Mike Barry is going to talk in a lot more detail in a couple of minutes. Once you do all that, you become a green community. We give you a green star. We give you these fancy road signs. And then you could get grant funds to do efficiency projects or renewable energy projects on municipal land. So this map shows all the stretch code communities as of about a month ago. There's 122. You can see Lone Newburyport up in the corner there. She would like some company. But we have, you know, ranging from, you know, Holyoke, Worcester, Springfield to, you know, the tiny towns in the Berkshires. So it's not something for the suburbs. It's not something for the big city. You know, this is something that any city or town can do. So right now we have 103 green communities. We just finished an application process, and we hope in the next couple of weeks to announce our new green communities, so we might have seven more. So you get those road signs I told you about, and you get an initial grant allocation just for meeting the five criteria. We'll say, here, Amesbury, this is how much money you can spend on energy projects. And essentially, it's based on $125,000 baseline, and then added to it is variables that have to do with the city, the community size, as well as socioeconomic status. So Boston got $1 million because they're really big. Hatfield got 130 because they're not so big. But it ranges. And I have a handout in the back that shows a map of all the green communities, and then it has a list the which communities they are, what their population is, how much they got, and what they propose to spend it on. So you can see they range from anything to renewable energy projects to new boilers. You know, some communities looking to do some things a little more innovatively ran weatherization programs for their residents. There's a bike sharing pilot going on, so it's fairly flexible. So here are the 103 green communities. And here's a sample of what some, you know, communities around here have spent the money on. And there's my contact information. Before I ask Mike to come up, does anybody have any general questions about the Green Communities program? But I would like to obviously spend most time on the stretch code, but since I'm up here. Okay, awesome.
Can I just jump in real quick too? So,
absolutely.
Just to put some context on the five requirements that Joanne raised with the City of Amesbury, back in April, the City Council adopted a solar overlay district for Amesbury, which completes the first requirement that you put out there. And essentially what we're doing is we're saying to the world, Amesbury is a good location for large-scale solar projects. We've identified commercial and industrial locations for them, and we've set out standards on how to site them properly. And so had a pretty robust discussion about this in the spring. This was adopted at the City Council level and signed, I guess, into law by the mayor. And then part two, the expedited process, is also going to be part of that. Through the Energy Task Force here in the city, we've accessed this database that you mentioned. It's a great service. We're able to see what the energy usage is for all of our town buildings, and we have a good handle on what's the most efficient, what's the least efficient, and so we're getting a good handle on that. We're also starting a process with the mayor on this model vehicle policy. We've done an initial look at our existing fleet and have projected what new vehicle needs are in the city. Looks like we're going to be in compliance. Doesn't seem to be a heavy lift here at the city level. A lot of exemptions, as you mentioned, for a lot of the emergency type vehicles and DPW type heavy equipment as well too. So on a good track. Obviously stretch code is the big item that's part of this discussion. So just a little bit of context for everybody so they know how we're progressing on the other pieces. Thank you. Let me just add one more thing that Joanne didn't mention, which is that Green Communities designation also has a benefit whereby the state is starting to add the designation as part of grant applications. So we're seeing, and I know Joe Fahey's here, but we've had some discussions about going after state grant funding for park and open space and land grants, and they require Green Communities designation as added bonuses. You get 5 points on your application, and it's a very competitive process. So the state is clearly starting to pull whatever resources they can to encourage cities and towns to adopt this, and so it's something we should just be thinking about. And then also, maybe we could talk about later with Newburyport, the Solarize program, which seems to be a pretty big success over there, is a program that's run by the state but is only eligible to green communities. So Amesbury does not become eligible for this program yet. So just some more context on the program outside of what Joanne mentioned from our perspective. So thank you.
Thank you. I'm Michael Berry. I work for a company called ICF International. We're a consulting firm based in Cambridge. We currently run the Massachusetts New Homes with Energy Star program, which is also changing its name to the Massachusetts Residential New Construction Program. So much shorter and easier to say. I'm here tonight. This is my 63rd stretch code talk that I've done, an informational session. Everyone's been different because I tailor everyone different to the town. Obviously what this is, it's an informational session. I'm gonna try to keep this very high level. How many builders do we have in the room? See a couple hands thrown up here and there. If there were a lot more builders in the room, when you hear code, I think all of us builders, which I'm one of them, I hold a mass construction supervisor's license, and have a building background and have been in energy efficiency for 14 years, you kind of cringe, because codes are law, you have to follow them, but they're hard to understand. And us as builders, we get these giant books and we're required to know everything in them. And it's tough to keep up with them because they're constantly changing. And this is part of a Massachusetts building code that we're hearing more and more of, and especially if you just saw the slide that Joanne has, which I also have in my slide deck, which is that 122 communities have adopted this. More than one third of the communities in Massachusetts now have this as their code, and over 50% of the residents in Massachusetts live in a stretch code town. So the biggest communities here have adopted: Springfield, Boston, Lowell. I mean, this is here, so it's not that it can't be done, it can be done. And there's a lot of misinformation out there, and I'm hoping that this presentation will clear it up. I'm also well aware to know that most of our questions, or most of your questions, will actually not probably be answered in my slides. They'll be answered after we're done. So if you can hold questions to the end, that would be great. But if something pops into your head and you really got to get it out and you want to ask, please do so. So it's not a lot of slides. So what I'm going to cover is the what and why of the stretch code, compliance and cost of the stretch code, and then talk a little bit about the future of the building codes. Not just the stretch code, but again, I mentioned building codes are constantly changing. What is a stretch code? The stretch code is an amendment to the base energy code. Here in Massachusetts, we have a building code, and part of that building code is the energy code. And way back when, in an earlier form of the building code, it was just a section inside the building code that told us what we did to address energy efficiency needs. Then the code changed and we adopted what they called the International Energy Conservation Code. This is a separate book. So we went from having one little section in our big building book, builders need to have in our permitting book, to now a separate book that only addresses energy. So this is part in any town, and Amesbury is one of them right now, that if you were to go pull a permit to build a new home here in Amesbury, you have to follow IECC 2009, the International Energy Conservation Code for 2009. The stretch code, which is an amendment to the energy code, which is known as Appendix 115AA, again, sorry having to go into this much detail, but the appendix is 15 to 20% more energy efficient than our base code. So in Newburyport, homes are being built by code 15 to 20% more energy efficient than they are in Amesbury, right off the bat. Commercial buildings have to build roughly about 20% more energy efficient. And you're gonna see later in my slides that that's not a real challenge for commercial buildings. Where we see the biggest challenge, and I will say this from my building background, is in residential, single family, new construction. Because a lot of builders have never done this kind of construction before. So there's a concern with the unknown. And again, my information session tonight is not gonna clear up everyone's concerns and fears about this kind of construction, but if nothing else, you're gonna see other communities have already done it. And we'll hear from maybe Newburyport on what's going on in their communities. We have a HERS raider in the room too, who works, Mike Brown, who's also an Amesbury resident, who works with these builders in these stretch code towns. So he can bring this into context as well. The code we're currently under, the base code I mentioned, was IECC 2009. It's 2012. Code adoption runs about 3 years in arrears. We're about to adopt the new code, which is called IECC 2012. This adoption is going to take place in 2013, because it takes 1 year for our state to publicly vet a code. So this stretch code that we have, though, currently in Massachusetts, is similar to IECC 2012. So when towns adopted the stretch code, they were actually adopting a code very similar to a code that was going to come sooner than later. So they're actually adopting in advance. So you're ahead of the curve. You're actually ahead of where the code's going to go with the stretch code. Enough with the code talk at that point. So what is the stretch code? We talked about it. It's one of the five criteria for a green community to become a green community. You did also see that there are less green communities than there are towns that adopt the stretch code. We do have some towns that are still trying to go for the green communities, some that adopted the stretch code, and that's all they're gonna do. Because they were able to adopt the code, they thought it was a good code for them. We actually have towns that have petitioned the Board of Building Regulations and Standards back 3-4 years ago for actually the adoption of more stringent energy codes. So towns were already asking to do this, but obviously they were concerned about towns adopting these codes here and here. One of the big things that we've heard is builders say, well, I don't like this because it's not a uniform state building code anymore. You know, it's not like you build in one town to this code, this is part of the building code. So it's still uniform. It's just each town has the option to adopt this amendment. It's an optional code. Why the stretch code? Whether it's to cut down our dependence on imported or foreign fuels, pollution, climate change, or as Joanne just spoke about, the ability to get grant money from municipal projects. Every town, again, I mentioned, adopts this code for a different reason, and every town, this code will affect their town in a different way. I just mentioned this, that several towns and cities were looking to adopt a stronger building code, especially in the energy efficiency side. And what the Board of Building Regulations and Standards said is they would rather have one alternative code, again, an optional code that towns could adopt, than having every town kind of create their own separate code. So this was done in conjunction. This wasn't just done so people could become green communities. This was done as a reaction to built towns asking for more stringent energy efficiency code. So in some form or fashion, whether it's for grants or because a town wants to be progressive on their building codes, this stretch code fills the bill. Joanne showed this slide earlier. This is actually an older slide, but again, speaks volumes. I live on the Cape. I was born and raised on the Cape. I did all my building on the Cape. I'm much like you guys. I live in the town of Dennis, and you can see Mashpee, Truro, and Provincetown have adopted the stretch code. So I always get a lot of grief because people say, well, you live on the Cape. Why aren't more towns adopting? Well, it's also these towns haven't been ready to do this. And Mashpee, Truro, Provincetown were really progressive and really wanted to look at this code. And what we found is builders are nomadic. They travel. So builders just don't build in one town. They build in multiple towns. So when Provincetown adopted it, it made sense that Truro adopted it, and now Wellfleet's looking to adopt it. So what ends up happening is that once a builder knows how to build to this code, it's just bound to happen that other towns are going to look into it, and there's less and less questions by the building community about it, because they start to have to do it in other communities. And whether they do it in your town or they do it in another town, sooner or later, they're going to build to this code. What does the stretch code apply to? It applies to residential additions, home renovations, and new construction. Pretty much everything that the standard energy code addresses. On the commercial side, it addresses 5,000 square foot commercial spaces, new construction additions, but renovations are exempt. So if you have a building in town, like a school building that's gonna be renovated, it doesn't have to meet the stretch code. If you have a commercial building here on Main Street that's under 5,000 square feet, it doesn't have to meet the stretch code. You're gonna see when I start talking about the residential portion of the stretch code that additions and home renovations are very similar to the base energy code, that IECC 2009 energy code that you are building to here in Amesbury now. The big difference you're gonna hear is in residential new construction. That's the biggest area where folks are affected by the stretch code. Under additions and renovations, so we look at that example of that down there, if that was an addition put onto a house. Currently in Amesbury, only that portion that's being added actually has to be brought up to code. That has to meet the current base code here in Amesbury. What we heard when the stretch code came out, well, I've heard when I put an addition on my house, the whole house has to be brought up to code. It's not true. Only the affected areas, just like under the base code, have to meet the stretch code. So if you're doing a kitchen renovation project, you don't open up any of the walls, you don't have to put a new boiler in or furnace. You don't have to add more insulation to your walls. Only the affected areas. It's similar to this, the base energy code in that sense. It's also similar that we have a prescriptive path and a performance path. What does that mean? The prescriptive path is basically a way that builders are building right now. The average builder in Massachusetts builds by the prescriptive path, which basically is, here's the energy code, here's the building code, you have to meet the criteria of this code in order to be, in order to get your certificate of occupancy or get your permit signed off on. There's another avenue that builders could take, but it's the path less traveled, I guess, by the building community, which is the performance path, but that's changing. The program I mentioned earlier that I run here in Massachusetts, the Massachusetts New Homes Program, currently our capture rate of the new construction market is 30%. So one in three homes here in Massachusetts is being built to an energy efficiency standard that requires performance testing. And the reason why is because consumers are starting to ask for it. We have national building companies like Pulte Homes that are doing it. We have small, single, one-off builders who build one to two, three houses a year that use this. They use it because it differentiates them in the market. It says to them, you know what, I could build a home to code, but I'm gonna build a home better than code. And the way they do that is through performance testing. Under the prescriptive path, when you address additions and renovations, again, only the affected areas have to meet the code. And on the prescriptive side, the only difference is that we require on the stretch code that your windows and doors are ENERGY STAR rated. The average window out there you're gonna find, or door you're gonna find, is always gonna have the ENERGY STAR rating on it. The base code requires you to have what they call a 0.35 window. The stretch code says 0.30, which is an ENERGY STAR window. And again, the average consumer is gonna always opt for the ENERGY STAR window. You're not gonna find someone who's on average gonna say, go out and buy me the worst possible window I can get installed. Or, you know, when I did this in Provincetown, someone got up and opposition and said, this is gonna put such a toll on all the little Portuguese grandmothers here in Provincetown. I don't know, but if my Portuguese grandmother lived in Provincetown, I would want her to have the best possible window she could have, that her oil heating system, which is all you're gonna have in Provincetown, oil and propane, you don't have natural gas, that all that heat's going to stay in her house and not go out her windows. And so the prescriptive path requires a little bit more on the energy, on the stretch code side, but it will follow along the same path as the base code. So when I did this, in Lowell, I was very surprised when Lowell adopted the stretch code, because to me, I didn't think it was going to be a good fit for that town. But they do a lot of renovations and a lot of addition work. And since it's similar to the base code, it really doesn't have to, they really don't have to change much. And a majority of the work that they're doing, if it's a historic building, by the way, it's exempt from the stretch code. And unlike the base code, which says historic buildings are exempt if they're on the federal register of historic homes, the stretch code says historic federal, state, or local. So if you have a local historic district, those homes are exempt. They don't have to, you don't have to put in a vinyl 0.30 window that's gonna not look right on a historic home. You can keep the original windows in there. With, you know, so one of the things they do is they want to keep this aligned with the code. The performance path's a little bit different. I'll get into that when we talk about new construction, but basically you're gonna work, the builder's gonna work with a HERS rater, but on a project like this, and Mike probably doesn't wanna hear me say this, you don't need to work with a HERS rater. In fact, testing a house like that, if only you're gonna address the new construction portion, to get an old home built in the 1800s to meet this performance path is gonna be very difficult. So that's why they give you the option of a prescriptive path. Basically, follow the code, put in your Energy Star windows, make sure that if you're adding new heating systems, the ducts have to be tight and tested, and then build a verified thermal bypass checklist, which I'm not gonna get into because it's basically just a checklist, again, very prescriptive in nature. New homes. So as I mentioned, this is where builders struggle the most with this, with the stretch code, because the performance path is the only option. Currently here in Amesbury, if you go to pull a permit to build a new home, you can build to the prescriptive path, again, follow the code to T, and you pass. Performance path, you work with a HERS rater and you'll have your home modeled. And this is where these codes differ. So the performance path is the only option, and you have to meet a HERS index. So what you see to the far right there is the HERS index. The HERS index was started by the energy efficiency mortgage industry to gauge how much a home could save in energy by making energy efficiency upgrades. What they say here is for a home that's 3,000 square feet or less, you have to meet a HERS index of 70. For a home 3,000 square feet or more, it's 65. The reason why you see that difference is because it's easier to actually have a bigger home save more energy. So we actually giving people a break here if you're gonna build less than 3,000 square feet. You're gonna work with a HERS rating company. So you're gonna work with someone like Mike Brown. Currently the program that I run, we have 46 HERS rating companies. So when I originally started to go out and do these, the big question I was asked was, are there enough HERS raters? Well, at the time, there really wasn't. And in fact, in 2007, when we came into Massachusetts, I think there were pretty much just one. There are other HERS raters, but there was one company that pretty much had the whole market. And now 6 years later, there's 46 companies and more. That's just the 46 work with my program. There are companies out here building an industry around this. So even if that doesn't sound like a lot, I think Mike could probably tell you, or any HERS rater could tell you, right now, we don't have any capacity issues. We don't hear builders clamoring and saying, I can't find a HERS rater. There are HERS raters out there. Yeah. What a HERS rating company does is they review your building plan. So what used to be where a builder would walk in to pull a permit, they'd come in with their building plans and they'd go in the permit office and want to pull a permit to build a new home. Now what's going to happen in a town that's adopted the stretch code is the building code official will say, have you met with a HERS rater yet? Have you met with a HERS rater? Have they reviewed your plans, and are you targeted to meet that HERS index? And when you meet with a HERS rater will talk to you. They'll take your plans, they run them through a software program, and they're going to look and say, well, right now you're at an 80, but if you increase your insulation, you put in a better window, a better heating system, you make some changes, maybe really small changes. And by the way, there's utility program rebates, which we talked about earlier, and you're gonna see there's a lot of money out there to cover the incremental costs to go to a more energy efficient heating system or cooling system or water system. or even just the whole house, there's money out there. And we as ratepayers, you pay a utility bill, you're eligible for this money. They're gonna review your plans, they're gonna work with the builder, they're gonna work with homeowners, they work with architects. They're gonna address again that thermal bypass checklist, which is, again, it's a prescriptive path. You have to do that. That's, again, one way where this code differs from the base code. We are requiring the thermal bypass checklist, but what that makes sure is being done is that homes, when insulation's installed, it's being installed properly. And we're not saying that the code is deficient or code officials are deficient in their work that they do, certifying that insulation's installed properly, but what we're looking at is it making contact on all sides? Is it being wrapped around outlet boxes or being properly cut out? We're not. So currently right now in Amesbury, if you install, you build a new home and you install a ducted system, so like a furnace, any ducts outside the conditioned space have to be tested. So this first, the second part of this is actually already code. The only difference is the stretch code requires you to have a blower door test done as part of performance testing. If you've never seen it done, they put a big fan on your house, they decompress your house, and what it does is it's gonna find all those areas that leak. And hopefully they can go back and they can seal them up before it's too late. But that leakage testing that gets done is really important because it's a final diagnostic test. This is the equivalent of dumping and putting a new engine into a car and just hooking it up and saying, okay, it's all set, driving away, not having it actually calibrated properly. So this is really important to be done. And the reason why I'm kind of highlighting that is because that new code that we're adopting, IECC 2012, will require a blower door test done on every newly constructed house. So towns that have adopted the stretch code, their builders are already doing this. In July 1st of 2013, which is when we're estimated to adopt the IECC 2012, every builder in Massachusetts is gonna have to do this. And I was just talking to Mike before this, and I was talking to a community that is thinking about adopting the stretch code, and they said, yeah, I know, but IECC 2012, and when it comes, I mean, we really don't have to do all of it, right? I mean, we don't have to do the blower door test. It's not a big deal. I mean, and I said, it's code, it's law. You have to do it. Whether it's enforced or not, that's something your town deals with. The big thing is it's coming. And so this performance testing work eventually will become code. So again, you're preparing the market. You're actually starting to kind of get people to start to do this. And we know that the compliance is always gonna struggle. We know that there are gonna be people out there who will miss some of these steps. But eventually, again, it will start to just be what we do with construction. We'll start doing performance testing more and more. And whether we do it because we adopt the voluntary code, we wanna participate in an energy efficiency program, or again, we just wanna build a house right, this is coming, the blower door testing. The home energy rating system, HERS index, again, I mentioned it's used by the Internal Revenue Service. You actually can get tax deductions using this. U.S. Department of Energy uses it. The EPA uses it for their Energy Star logo. And again, the mortgage industry used it early on to figure out whether or not energy efficiency upgrades were cost effective for homeowners. One of the big questions I always get when I do these is, okay, so this is great. So now we have HERS raters out there working with builders. who oversees the HERS raters and who sets the standard that HERS raters oversee. It's governed by a group called the Residential Energy Services Network, or ResNet, which is a national group. And they set the technical standards, the testing procedures, the quality assurance. So if anyone's familiar with the real estate industry here in Massachusetts or across the nation, a real estate agent can sell real estate, but they have to work for a broker. And the broker's job is to make sure the real estate agent's doing everything that the real estate agent's legally supposed to do. HERS raters have to work for a provider. So HERS raters actually have someone who's overseeing their work and making sure they're following these standards. There's a code of ethics, there's complaint resolution, so there's another area to go to. If you're a builder and you have a grievance with something that was done, there's a formal policy to discuss this with. So this isn't some fly-by-night organization. This has been around for over 20 years now, and they meet yearly, they have board meetings, they have local representation, and they really are a very strong group. Just like I'm, just as a builder here in Massachusetts, I have to take continuing education credits now to keep my license up. HERS raters have to do the same thing. So they're always up on the latest and greatest information, whether it's code compliance or energy efficiency technology. ResNet oversees that. I've been touching upon some of these during my presentation. The misconception, the stretch code is new and experimental. The NG Star Homes program that's been using HERS ratings and performance testing has been around since 1997. And so that portion's been around for a while. There's been a performance path in the code for at least when I got my license, the 7th edition of code book, it was in there. So it's been around for a while here in Massachusetts. Again, not the path taken by most builders, but again, has been around for some time. The stretch code requires mechanical ventilation. We touch upon this because the other misconception people have is that we're gonna tighten up houses so much that we're gonna create mold and mildew issues. I can tell you right now, the average home, even the homes that go through my program that are considered pretty tight, aren't tight enough that we're concerned about that issue. We actually, through my program, require so much ventilation that we're still overventilating a house. But we want it there because it's a safety issue. But again, we address these. HERS raters follow standards, and one of the things they have to do is they have to make sure a house isn't too tight. They also need to add ventilation if needed. But they do that based on their performance testing and going through the actual final testing of the home and the tightness that the home achieves and whether or not the need for mechanical ventilation is there. That homes that heat with oil cannot meet the stretch code. This is not true either. We've actually had a lot of homes, again, Truro, Provincetown, some of the homes out in Western Mass. You saw on that map how many Western Mass towns adopted, and all that's out there is deliverable fuel. You don't have natural gas as an option. And lastly, town residents will be required to update their existing homes. Just like any other code adoption, unless you do something, you pull a permit, that's the only thing that triggers a stretch code. So if you're pulling a permit that's gonna require you to address the energy efficiency portions of your home, like opening your walls up or changing out your heating system, things that you wouldn't do anyhow that would trigger the code, that's the only time that you actually have to do that. And I just realized there's an E missing after it required. So the programs that I oversee here in Massachusetts, I mentioned that in 2010 we had 30%. We're targeted this year at 32% of the market. There's incentives to builders, homeowners, it doesn't have to just be a builder, it's whoever applies, of $750 to $8,000 for a single family home. $8,000 is a very, very high performance home. We had, when we first started this, we had 30 homes meet the standard. This year we have 100. So again, going from 2 years ago when we put out the $8,000, we said, some builders will do it. We're starting to see a trend where builders are striving to meet that $8,000 challenge. The average builder gets about $1,250 through our program for each home. But when you start to rack up the additional rebates that they're available for appliances, heating, cooling, lighting, by the way, again, under the base code here in Amesbury, you have to put in 50% of all your lights have to be energy efficient if you were to build a new home. In 2013, we adopted a new code, 75%. You participate in this program, all your lighting's free. So again, you're gonna have to do it, whether you adopt the stretch code or your base code, you have to address lighting. there's an option here for assistance. And again, if you're a ratepayer and you've been paying National Grid here in Amesbury, you're eligible for these funds. You're eligible for these funds even if you're not building a new home. If you're living in an existing home and you haven't had an audit done to your home, you should do it. Has anyone had an audit done to their home? So anyone else who hasn't, didn't raise their hand, these guys are all thankful that you paid into it and they took advantage of it, but you should as well, because this is our funds that we actually put into our bills every month when we pay, that this money's here. We also help subsidize the HERS raters. We don't cover all their costs. The cost that a HERS rater will charge varies, and it's all based on what the builder and the HERS rater negotiate. The HERS rater becomes a subcontractor to the builder, just like an HVAC sub or an insulation subcontractor. The HERS rater will work with the builder, and based on the level of service that the HERS rater is providing the builder, they'll negotiate a fee for service. They go through the utility program. We're going to pay the HERS rater, as long as they're in our program, up to $900, which can really offset those costs. Cost of the stretch code, I know that this is an area of question with a lot of people. And before we started this, I was talking to Mike, and we've actually seen that the costs in stretch code towns actually at times are lower than base code towns, the actual incremental costs. Back in 2010, we adopted IECC 2009. We went from a code that was here, a base code, to a code that was here. The stretch code was here. So if this was $5,000 to go from one base code to another base code, and then $5,000 to go from the base code to the stretch code, people out there were going, well, it costs $10,000 to meet the stretch code. No, it actually only costs $5,000. You would have had to still pay the $5,000 because of the change in the base code. The base code we're going to adopt is going to cost builders more money to build homes in 2013. So the incremental cost studies that you're seeing here is the cost to go from the base energy code to the stretch code. So back in 2010, that number up top for a single family home could have been $6,000. But you would already had to pay the $3,000 just to meet the new code here in Massachusetts. And again, these are the costs even without the subsidies in there. So you start putting in that $1,250, the rater subsidy, the lighting subsidy, the appliance subsidies you can apply for, these costs actually decrease, and then the actual cost of your mortgage will actually decrease as well. So you're looking at the single family home, 2,672 square feet, it's the average home that we actually have built here in Massachusetts. To go from the base energy code here in Massachusetts, IECC 2009, to the stretch code, the average cost. Now these costs vary. We're aware of that. In some towns they might be lower, some towns they might be higher. But it's about $3,000. The additional cost to your mortgage is $214. But look at your savings. Your annual savings is $507. This is what Mike and I were talking about, which is that's where it really comes out to. Is the savings that you're getting in a stretch code house compared to a base code house will actually decrease those costs. You'll see as the home obviously gets bigger, there's more savings there. You can also see the decrease with the incentives, which I think speak very highly to the fact that there's tons of incentives out there that you should tap into to decrease those overall costs. Just quickly on the commercial stretch code, I mentioned early on that the commercial stretch appendix applies only to new buildings and additions, doesn't renovations are exempt, only buildings over 5,000 square feet. And unlike the residential stretch code, you do have two options to address new construction and additions, but you have a performance option, which you have to go 20% below the commercial code, or prescriptive option for buildings that fall between 5,000 and 100,000 square feet. To be honest with you, a lot of buildings you'd see really aren't challenged on the commercial side with a stretch code. We use this building as an example. This is the Fidelity Bank building in Leominster, Massachusetts. This wasn't built, this Leominster's adopted the stretch code. This was built way before the stretch code. This was built, I think, 4 years before there. One of the things that they wanted to look at, Fidelity wanted to look at, low operations costs. You ever go by buildings on the 120, on 128, and they're lit up like a Christmas tree all hours of the day, whether occupied or not? Fidelity knew this, that they would pay a lot in electrical costs and heating costs. So one of the things that they did is they started to look at where their improvements would be. And what they looked at was what their cost would be to operate this building, and then look at where they wanted to upgrade. And one of the biggest upgrades they made were in their HVAC systems, their heating, ventilation, and air conditioning systems. And then second to that was lighting. And again, all the lighting upgrades on this building and the heating upgrades were paid by the utilities. So actually the incremental cost of what they were gonna install to the high performance option was subsidized 100% by the utilities. They factored those into their costs, and basically what they found out was they spent about $100,000 extra. They got about $66,000 in incentives through the utilities. The owner probably put out about $34,000. The utilities cover materials for heating systems. They don't cover the labor, so a lot of that was labor cost. Their return on their investment without incentives was 3.7 years. Their return with the incentives was 1.2. So from a bank's perspective, that's a pretty good rate of return. And it made sense, and they just did this on their own. So commercial builders can do this because they already work in modeling software. So it's easier for a commercial developer to say to their energy modeler, hey, listen, I have to meet the stretch code. I have to be 20% more energy efficient, drive the building down, and oh, by the way, look for what utility rebates are out there. Code compliance inspections, same as base code. The code official still has final say. The difference is that the energy efficiency side for new construction, again, only way you can do it's performance path, you're working with a HERS rater. The HERS rater is gonna give all the documents to the builder that the builder needs to have the permit signed off or the CO issued. The building official still approves the documents, they still do their checks that they have to do. They still have their mandatory checks that they have to do in the field. It doesn't take anything away from your code official. In fact, again, it adds that layer of another set of eyes out there doing this work. There's a ton of training out here. If I didn't bore you enough going into the code, you can take trainings on this. The program I run, you can actually find out more about it, the easiest thing. And if you, again, not to pitch energy efficiency too much, but if you haven't had an energy audit done, you're thinking about upgrading an appliance, a heating system, cooling system, massave.com, go there. It's a central clearinghouse for all rebates. Please check it out. We pay into this. Again, you should take advantage of it. And again, there's also trainings on there that are posted all the time. So. The future of the stretch code is one that's kind of uncertain right now. We are adopting a new base code here in Massachusetts, and as we adopt the new base code, the stretch code will change. It has to, because again, we're 10 to 15% more energy efficient now than the base code. We're not certain where it's gonna be, but we know it's gonna be some bit more energy efficient than the base code. But basically right now that we know is that we're targeted here in Massachusetts to adopt the base energy code in 2013 on July 1st. The stretch code will follow suit, and Joanne will be able to provide additional information to towns that we're doing this to on the new stretch code. We actually think that we're gonna see probably some additional PASA compliance maybe to help builders out. We think that there's gonna also be some additional ways that it will align more with IECC 2012 since we're gonna be requiring performance testing. So it might not be as much of a stretch, but more to come on that. Questions? I know it's a lot.
I have a little almost 2 months plus years old.
It wouldn't require, unless you touch the furnace. So the question is, at what point does the stretch code, I was asked to repeat it, so what point does the stretch code, does the stretch code kind of get triggered on a renovation project, especially of an older home that's over 200 years old? And a point of clarification to what I was saying. So basically, you only have to address, so let's use your window example first. You open up a wall because you're putting in a new window. Well, currently here in town, if you open up a wall, if that cavity does not meet the full requirement of insulation, so basically say there's no insulation or minimal insulation, you're required by code already to fill that cavity to the max amount of insulation that that cavity can hold.
I think what you said is that you did correct me, please, I'm wrong. I think you stated that you used the kitchen renovation as an example.
Yep.
And you stated something, please, again, for
yep.
When you open up the wall in the kitchen, there's a point where you now have to look at the boiler.
Oh no, I think what I was getting at was you only would have to address the boiler if it was part of your renovation. Like if you were, yeah. Yeah, but it doesn't, yeah, and but.
So the only way that we can't afford equipment is that's the key on the microphone.
Yeah.
This comes up a lot. We get calls from towns which are stretch code towns asking for our HERS Rater services because they think they need them, and they don't. There's a prescriptive path. The prescriptive path is very simple. It has no minimum efficiencies for any mechanical equipment, neither in the base code nor in the stretch code.
I think
he's worried that he's going to have to do something to his boiler that's different from the base code, and there absolutely is nothing different.
I think
I'm asking Mr. Perry to clarify
the
statement that he made.
Yeah.
To clarify my statement, you don't have to touch the boiler. The boiler doesn't have to be upgraded unless you're actually upgrading the boiler. Only the affected areas. So literally, if you open up a wall cavity and you open up a 16-inch stud bay, and that's all you open up, you only have to fill that 16-inch stud bay.
You don't have to touch the remainder of the house.
If the rest of the walls were devoid of insulation, you would not have to address them, which is totally blows my mind why you'd want to do that, but the code requires only the affected areas and only that depth that you can fill that cavity. So it's not gonna make you go to an R20 insulation. If you can only fill 3 inches of insulation in there, you fill 3 inches of insulation.
Therefore, would a HERS Rater be required?
Nope. So that's where, and again, thank you for bringing that up. That was a great point of clarification. I think I was at that point going very quickly, which I tend to do at times, and brought up the fact that the boiler would only have to be changed out if it was part of your job, like part of your specs that you were doing. Like a kitchen renovation, if you were just changing out the cabinets and you weren't opening up walls, you're not triggering the energy code, so you don't have to address the energy code.
Just one last question.
Yep.
You just stated that mold didn't seem to be a good fit, in your opinion, to adopt the stretch code. So there are certain communities, in your opinion, that, you know, wouldn't be a good fit for the stretch code?
What I was getting at with Lowell was because here's a town that I was thinking, you know, it's an added burden you're going to put onto a town. But when I realized that for a city like Lowell and other cities that, again, I mentioned early on that for every city, it's different. And it fits for some cities. I've done this talk to towns that haven't adopted it. Falmouth on the Cape, I've done the talk 3 times. I've gone there and spoken to it. And all 3 times, again, this is an informational session. It just wasn't a good fit for Falmouth at that point. Does that mean that Falmouth might never adopt it? We don't know. Maybe they adopt it next year. What my point with Lowell was is that Lowell, the type of buildings you see in Lowell tend to be older triple-decker buildings. And if you were building a new home in Lowell, which I didn't know there wasn't a lot of new construction in Lowell, that a majority of the work was renovation additions, and it's similar to the code. And a lot of the buildings that are being built there are mill building conversions, which fall into historic charter, which are exempt by the code. So it was a perfect code for Lowell. But from an outsider's perspective, I didn't think it was a good fit. But Lowell actually was one of our first early adopters of the stretch code and one of the first green communities. And I was shocked because I did the introductory talk, went and spoke at the town meeting as well. And I was surprised how little resistance it got. I actually expected to go in there to quite a fight. So it varies, it really does.
Just thank you very much for that.
Yeah, I appreciate your questions. I understand the question. So the question was, a concern of when does the codes, we're going to continue to adopt codes, we're going to continue to change the codes, they're going to get stronger and stronger, more energy efficient. I mean, they're going to continue to push people further. But the other side of this is, we also have learned through the years a better way to build homes. And it is putting a burden on people, but the one thing you can control, you can't control energy costs, but you can control how much energy you're using.
Yeah, but
I think I should also point out that I'm not mandating anything. I don't write the code. I'm here. This is an informational session. So the state of Massachusetts adopts codes. I'm here to talk about them. The state, when they have a new building code come through, they have several public hearings and public informational, so folks like you can go and state exactly what you stated and let the state know that you think this is an undue burden. But you know what, unfortunately, people don't go and say that. So people are concerned about that, but currently right now, we have a building code in Massachusetts. We have a portion of that code is energy, an energy code, which is one of the most stringent energy codes in the country. Never mind the optional stretch code. So we already have that. And again, it's an optional code. So this is a choice for towns to adopt. So again, if it's not a good fit for Amesbury, then Amesbury shouldn't adopt it. However, if this is what the town is looking to do and looking to set people into a better home, there's already code there. So there's already that framework in place. This is just an option to help people go even farther. So I don't know beyond that. If I can address that any better or worse. Yes, the base code is going, base energy code is going from IECC, the International Energy Conservation Code of 2009 to 2012. It will be some efficiency better than the base code, but I don't know what it will be. It might be less than 15%. It probably won't be more than, because the other thing with energy efficiency, you get to a point of diminishing return, that you start getting to a point that sometimes, unless you're putting on-site generation like solar or some type of renewables, that you're not gonna get any further. So the code's gonna also have to align with the base code as well, like you saw the current stretch code does. So we don't know, I don't know. And it hasn't been made public yet. So when it does, people can go and hear it and also speak to it. Yep. Nope. No, so great, fantastic question. So the question is if Amesbury adopts the stretch code today, let's say, and on July 1st, 2013, a new stretch code comes, and let's say you guys go, you know what, not a good code for us, we're not ready, we don't want to do it. You would lose your designation, but you would have also received your funding for the designation that you got. Do you want to speak to this a little bit? Or? Yeah, so basically you'd have to vote it out. So in the spring, you guys would, in a town meeting, if you decide you didn't want it, you'd put it on as a ballot question, you'd vote it out. If you didn't vote out the stretch code, you would automatically adopt it in 2013. But you would lose your designation.
Thanks for coming to the City Councilor, Derek Kimball. In full disclosure, my day job, The lower the score, the better.
Yeah.
Now, we've seen, at least in our world, scores that come in much lower than that. So builders are building much more energy efficient homes. And in fact, even what are considered to be zero energy homes. Yep. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Yeah, so the question or the comment was around the HERS index, and that I like the comparison of a golf score as someone who's never broken 100. But you see with this, the standard new home, which actually this is an older slide, that was based on the old IECC 2007 code. The average home that went through performance testing, it was about 100 on the HERS index. We heard that the stretch energy code requires builders to be roughly between a 65 and 70. So again, you're moving down some, whether it's 30% or 25% more energy efficient than the code. The current code we're in, Mike, where are we falling on IECC 2009 on average for a performance home, did you say? So, so the current code we're under, I mentioned that this one here is IECC 2007, the old code we had. Mike just mentioned, for folks that didn't hear him, that basically that we have homes being built to the IECC 2009 code, which is the code that's current here in Amesbury, that are falling right above the E. Again, moving down. The stretch code requires you to be about 65 or 70, but there's a option under the IECC code, the base code, of about a 75 that you can hit. But as the question and the comment in the back room was that as you move down this, you're moving down to what they call net zero homes. Net zero homes put back as much energy as they use, so basically they net out at the end. Although this isn't the norm that you see here in the state of Massachusetts, we've had homes that come in at negative numbers, which means that they're putting more power back into the grid on a routine basis, that they're actually getting money back from the utilities. They're actually generating power. And we, even though, again, not the norm, it's the exception, we are seeing homes, we've had homes in, I think, negative 20s. We've had homes that right now they're targeting the city of Boston to be in the negative 30s. So it can be done. It's not, again, not what we're seeing on a routine basis, but we're seeing more and more net zero homes being built because people like the fact, you want to talk about independence, what a great way, and as you mentioned, full disclosure, you work for a utility. If you're not getting utility, you don't have a utility bill and the utilities are paying you, I mean, what a great world we live in, that you're actually getting money back and you're not paying into this. Now, I know in Arizona, there's a company right now that's building net zero homes brand new, and they're competing in a market where in Arizona there's a ton of foreclosures. You can pick up a home in Arizona for $40,000, but it was built in 1970 and has the same air conditioning system that it had in 1970, the same insulation, if any insulation in it, from 1970. And this guy down the road's building net zero homes for $140,000, and you don't have a utility bill. I mean, so you weigh it out, you buy a home, you have to renovate it, you do all that work, or you can buy a net zero home. He's selling houses. There's a gentleman in Massachusetts named Carter Scott who built a development that I think is in Unitel's territory, and they're all net zero homes. And in a down market, he's selling houses. Because again, when I sold real estate on the Cape for a couple of years, people didn't care about what kind of insulation was in the walls, they didn't care about what kind of heating system was in the basement, they cared about what kind of countertops you had, what kind of cabinets you had. Now we got people asking, how much energy does this home use? What is my average utility bill gonna be like? You got people buying cars based 100% on its fuel efficiency. I mean, your biggest investment the average person is gonna make is a home. And why wouldn't you wanna move down this score here? And again, this is an optional code. This is not something that the town has to adopt, But right now, if you were to build a home, why wouldn't you want to build a high-performance home? And again, you're carrying those costs, the first cost of doing energy efficiency in your mortgage. You're getting to pay at probably 3 to 4% of a mortgage rate right now, and your energy costs are going to rise at a rate 3 to 4% every year, but your mortgage is going to remain flat for 30 years and your energy usage is going to remain similar. Your bill's probably still going to go up because you're going to be paying more for what you're using, but you're going to be using the same amount, if not less. Any additional? So the question was about unintended consequences to adopting the stretch code, and the example, which I think was a really good example, which was the tornadoes that hit Springfield. Springfield adopted the stretch energy code, and it's a great example because we were actually, personally, I was involved in the rebuild efforts in Springfield, still are, working with Joanne's organization, Department of Energy Resources, addressing the exact thing that you brought up, which is that the insurance companies tend to only cover what is code. And we got in this argument, this dogfight with insurance companies, regardless of whether or not some insurance companies viewed this as a code or not, it's a code, it's a state code, it's state law. And a lot of insurance companies said, well, we're only gonna pay to the base code. And because Springfield adopted the stretch code, we're not gonna pay the difference. But we also heard that some insurance companies, when pushed, and we're actually told that this is state law, it's part of the building code. They actually pay the difference, or in certain circumstances, the state of Massachusetts or the utilities, Western Mass Electric, National Grid, or Columbia Gas actually paid the difference, the incremental cost difference. Honestly, your example is probably one of the biggest I've heard of as far as, or a good example of what maybe would be a drawback as far as when you have a natural disaster like that. The other issue is that although the state has a mandatory code, and the code here in Massachusetts is the base code, and that's the code that we adopt, towns can adopt more stringent portions of the code. Like a town can say, you know what, we'd like to actually enforce more in this one area of the code. They can actually go to BBRS, the Board of Building Regulations Standards, and actually up that. So if a building or town feels like, let's say they want to put something in for fire safety, and it's something that the town, say, of Amesbury really thinks is important, the building inspector thinks it's important, the building community gets behind it, they can actually petition BBRS. Now, in that example, the same example that you use, the insurance companies probably wouldn't cover that because it's not part of the statewide code, it's part of the town code. Now, one of the things that I've actually dealt with more, I think, is on the compliance side, is one of the biggest issues that towns have with the stretch code, but they also have the adoption of any new energy code, is compliance. Is getting the information out to the community, getting, so a builder isn't caught in a situation where a new homeowner comes into your town and says, I really want to build a home in your town. The builder says, great, let's do it. Draws up a set of plans, goes into the town offices, the town office says, we're a stretch code town. Have you worked with a HERS rater? And now the builder has to go back to the homeowner and say, there's additional cost to build here in Amesbury. But that's where our job is, to educate those builders. So we're not scaring people out of wanting to build in a town. We want them to embrace the thought of building in Amesbury because the homes that they're gonna build are more energy efficient. So that, someone asked me once in this, wouldn't you think adopting the stretch code would be more beneficial for my town, and our town would be a better town to live in? I can't answer that, but honestly, you're tapping the green communities funding, you're probably upgrading some buildings in your town that really need the upgrades, but you're also giving people the best possible home. So I can't speak to any other, you know, things that I think would be a concern. I don't know if maybe Newburyport, since you guys adopted, if you guys had any examples or any thing that came out to you that.
I was gonna invite Holly up if she wanted to speak. So. Any other questions though for Mike before we do that?
So I am Molly Ettenborough. I'm the City of Newburyport's Energy and Recycling Coordinator, and I was the one that brought the Green Communities Act to the forefront of our City Council. We didn't have the good fortune of having a City Councilor step up and do that at first, but we had, you know, we had a lot of questions. We had a lot of public input. So I was just going to just talk to you about why we decided to do this and what it has meant for us. And my colleague Sarah Holden is a volunteer from Newburyport, and she was extremely helpful, and she'll talk a little bit about what the experience has been, as particularly with the builders that we've worked with so far. But we wanted to become involved in the Green Communities program because we were interested in getting the grants that are not based on demographics. There's a lot of grants that we're not eligible for, just demographics alone. We wanted to reduce our energy costs, both in our municipal buildings, but also for our residents. We wanted to help maintain our city buildings. And we also wanted to, you know, look at the environmental impacts of greenhouse gases and promote energy efficiency. So those were the main reasons that we wanted to do it. But I will say this, it had a huge added benefit, and that is making us more accountable. And so the third criteria, which is the benchmarking and the energy plan, that forced us to put all of our energy usage for our municipal buildings into a software called Mass Energy Insight. And all we did was put all of our electricity and natural gas usage, also oil, and our vehicle usage into this software, our account numbers, and every year that's updated automatically. I was doing that myself I had just started it for 1 year with a different software, and I had to input it every time. Now it's all automatically updated, so we didn't even have to do it. It's a great tool. We can now print out reports, and you know, we're accountable both to city councilors, the mayor, anybody who wants to know how efficient our buildings are, how our buildings are doing. It's a benchmark for us, and it's a way that we can report on what we're using for energy in Newburyport. It also forced us to come up with an energy reduction plan, and it's a 5-year plan where we're hoping to reduce our energy costs by 20%. So it really has made us more accountable to what we're doing and really take a hard look at how we're spending our money, at least in terms of energy. And then as Christian alluded to, the other benefits is we were eligible for the Solarize program. We had no idea how successful that program would be, but that was a program only available to green communities, and it's a residential program. And anyone that was interested in solar was invited to get a quote for solar, and we had a lot of people that were interested in it. If we met 250 kW, overall, then the price would drop to the highest tier, and we actually had 423 kW. So we almost doubled what we needed to meet. And all of those people, there's 46 homes in Newburyport are now going to be getting solar on their homes, and their cost is dramatically lower than what it would have been if they had done it on their own. It's kind of a bulk buying program, but that was all sponsored by the state and through Mass CEC, Mass Clean Energy Center. And that was a benefit if you were a green community, which is not really something. And then we have our grant, and then Sarah can talk more about you know, any of the things if you have questions specifically about the grant, but we received $155,000. We used that on our police station, on our EMS system, the energy management system, to upgrade that, on an HVAC system and some insulation. And then City Hall, like yours, very old, we needed a lot of insulation there, and we needed some heating control units that we're putting. So we spent $155,000 upgrading those buildings, and we hope and expect to see significant savings there. So those were our reasons and what we've done with our money, and Sarah can talk to you more about stretch code and what the effects have been on our building industry in Newburyport and how people have reacted to it.
So I don't have a lot of good, really juicy anecdotal stories because really there hasn't been any issues with it in Newburyport. So back in 2010, I attended a bunch of meetings just like this, and we had a lot of builders that voiced a lot of really valid concerns because they were being presented with something that they weren't really sure what it was about and how it was going to affect them. It was a time when the economy for builders was not so great, much worse than it is now even. So there was a lot of concern, as you can imagine. As it turned out, though, the state was about to adopt the 2009 IECC, which was a big jump from what they were already experiencing and very similar to where the stretch code was pointing us. So they didn't see a lot of, it wasn't going to be a huge jump for them once the state adopted the 2009. So since, I think it was July 2011 when the stretch code went into effect, we have had upwards of 20 new residential, single family residential projects in Newburyport under the new regulations, and we have not heard of any issues on these projects. Now, I don't have Gary Calderwood here to tell you if, you know, he had a lot of pushback, but in my short conversation with him, he didn't say that there were any big issues around it. The builders, in fact, and we had some of this happen at the meetings, the builders, in fact, found that they were already building to the standards, and I think that's what you'll find if you talk to Mike or talk to some of the builders who are currently building. So that's really all I wanted to say about Newburyport, but Molly did mention the grant. I helped manage the project for that in Newburyport, so if anybody wants to understand a little bit more about what we did exactly with all that money, feel free to talk to me afterwards.
I had a question over here.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. Okay.
So far,
nice to see you.
Thank you.
you're saying
it. I hear it. Yep.
And Joanne might want to say something about that. Newburyport got $155,000 in our grant, so that's what we received. As far as if you want to add anything, but I hear what you're saying, and I think there is a lot of bureaucracy. But if the state isn't mandating it, will we really do this? I mean, will a town really make the effort to do this? I mean, you're forced to do it, and it's something that you want to do.
The answer was yes. We did this. We wrote the report. We did all this. It was a small committee. We didn't. It came down to do this. The solar panels are on the top of the high school right now. We poured it upstairs.
That was paid for through federal stimulus monies for the program. So. But it came from another pot of government funds that are available to municipalities, and took advantage of it.
That particular solar panel, not report, not writing the grant, those are all paid out.
And I don't see where we would have to pay for, if their green communities money wasn't there, what we would be paying for. There's nothing that we would have to pay for. I mean, the builders are going to build the homes, and the residents are paying for that. There's nothing else that us as a community or Amesbury as a community has to pay for to be a green community. So I don't understand that argument.
Indirectly, we will either have to pay for it because we would still have to fund the green community guards.
So let me just jump in there and explain a little bit of this. I had a previous history of working for the state's energy office, so I can speak to, I think, some of the issues. And I don't necessarily want to get into a debate about the Green Communities Program, but I at least want to answer your question. 2008 legislation adopted creates the Green Communities Program. It's $10 million authorized through proceeds that come back, a portion of the proceeds that come back from the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative. Regional cap and trade program set up, working well here in New England. It's the law, it's in place. $10 million of that, it's not coming from an appropriation. It's not subject to annual appropriations through the legislature line items that you may talk about on education funding. It's outside of that scope. On top of that, there's also payments that go into a separate fund when utilities don't meet their benchmarks on their renewable portfolio standards. So what's happening with the state, and again, this is at least from my perspective, the reason why I've tried to draw some attention to this is that the law is the law, and the state laws are being very aggressive on a number of fronts. We look at greenhouse gas law now that's in place, which requires an 80% reduction in greenhouse gases by 2050, 25% by 2020. The state is saying out of that plan, 40% of it has to be met through energy efficiency. So there's a bigger framework here in which the state is saying we want to be the most aggressive in the state, in the country. We're putting resources, $125 million. I know, Mike, you talked about resources that are available. Your utility bill, you're paying a surcharge that goes into a dedicated fund of $125 million annually. That's your money for these purposes. Same thing, RGGI auction proceeds also cover a big portion of this as well, too. That's what the 2008 law set up. And so the thing for me that I find most interesting about this is in less than 4 years, 122 cities and towns have signed up for this, I think because, at least in my mind, it's the new reality. I don't think this is changing. This is the law. The 2008 law was created just this past year. Another energy law, which made it even more aggressive, was adopted on top of this greenhouse gas bills law. And so it's very clear to me, and I think to a lot of cities and towns, that the writing is on the wall. This is not going to change. It's been validated by the state government over and over again. Resources are there. I think there's an argument to be made that we should be jumping on this train, because otherwise I think we do a bit of a disservice by not being able to access some of our own funds that the state is holding back by not getting these. And as I think Mike said, the difference here is pretty marginal for the most part on what the existing base is. So again, I don't want to get into too much of a debate on this. I just wanted to at least give you my perspective. And I know it's just one person's perspective on this. Not everybody is in agreement on it, but sure.
This is Scorzoni. Thank you very much. I just wanted to reiterate something I think that Mr. Campbell said earlier with respect to builders are building homes, you know, obviously more efficient. Mr. Perry said that the average consumer is going to buy Energy Star products. I think what Mr. Dunford was saying earlier is that folks are really going to, you know, they're here in Amesbury are looking towards becoming green on their own. Correct me if I'm wrong, that's what you were saying.
Right.
What benefit is there then for us to adopt something, you know, after the fact, when there's going to be, like Mr. Dunford said, probably potentially a very small amount of money if all these communities are going to be competing with us for it?
Sure. It's a valid point, and I guess it's something for us to talk about, I know, at the council level, and I appreciate the input. You know, as we talk about, at least from our perspective, money's tight. Obviously, we know what our tax rate's like, and we have to think about leveraging every resource available to help offset our costs at the municipal level. You know, we heard from Molly and from Mike talk about them being able to pay for boilers for their schools. We have an appropriation that's coming through pretty soon for us at the town level. That's just going to come out of our operating budget, which is hitting the property tax rate. There's grant funding available to us by potentially making this change that would cover that cost outside of our own existing operating fund. So, I mean, that's the question I think that's on the table for folks to think about. But again, I don't necessarily want to get into, you know, this discussion on green communities. I know we have that ability to do that at the council. But let me just also say, to be clear, we're not in a rush to adopt this. I'm not in a rush to adopt it as one of the sponsors. I recognize it's complicated. I want to get the information out there. I want folks to vet this, hear all sides on it. I know it's very complicated, and I do want to keep this conversation going. This isn't something that's going to happen tomorrow. And I know that from a formal perspective, the ordinance itself has to go both before the ordinance committee and finance, as well as the full council. So there's a number of steps here to be vetted on. So I just want to sort of put that out there and let folks know that, you know, there are no immediate decisions on this. I want to take it slow. I want to make sure people have the right information on it. So.
Christian, just let me re-ask the question of the two young ladies from your report. You've been in this 4 years.
Alan, do you want to come up?
No.
Okay.
How many total dollars in grants?
2 years.
I'm sorry, 2 years. How many total dollars in grants have you been on board?
155,000. Yeah, and the five lots. And it's
right.
155,000. And the loss of the police station, EMS, HVAC, and the station.
Are you any other grants pending?
We have one more.
So the benefit to our community would be find free cash like that to upgrade some of our existing things, and we don't have to give the tax rate.
The other thing, just
benefit for us, and you've already found some cash.
I just
The
thing that we talked about earlier too that I think is important, at least for folks to know, is that at the city level, we're looking for grant funding in the parks area. We're looking very hard to get funding for Heritage Park downtown, Town Park, and others. And again, the state is now saying green communities designation is worth a certain amount of points on your application. And these grants are competitive, and a 5% difference on an application could make or break whether or not we're eligible for this funding. So it's something for us to be cognizant of as well, too. But happy to answer more questions. I know it's been a long time. We have coffee here. I didn't expect to go this late. Mike, I appreciate your time. Joanne, Molly, Sarah, thank you very much. Any other questions before we wrap up? Or?
Can I just make one
sure.
comment? I want to thank you very much for putting this together. I know you have a lot of effort forth on this. And it's not often that you have this opportunity to have somebody such as yourself, you know, put such a great, you know, coalition of folks together more
on
something you should try to, you know, help.
Thank you. Councilor Kelcourse, thank you very much for that. I appreciate it. Yes, ma'am.
I'd like to see a meeting where we can give all the opinions and all the perspectives.
Sure. Well, again, as I mentioned earlier, we are going through the legislative process here in town. The bill has just been filed. It hasn't had a hearing yet. This is an added layer of information that I've asked for my fellow colleagues. It's a dense area. I don't necessarily have all the details on it. I've asked for some folks that are experienced in this and have gone town to town and build who have that experience to come here and to provide that information. But we are going to, this is an additional step on top of the normal course of ordinances that come through the city. So that will most certainly happen at the city council level, and I encourage you to come and participate as well too. So thank you. Anybody else? Well, I appreciate the time. I know it's dense stuff. I know how busy everybody is. And thank you again for coming out. And we will keep you posted on the activities. One other thing I will say is that we've put information about the stretch code on the town's website, frequently asked questions, information about the Green Communities Program, all that. So please go to www.amesburymass.gov for further information. We also have a sign-in sheet and handouts here, too, for folks. So thank you very much. Have a great night. I appreciate your time. Thanks.